We're going to have to do a really in-depth study on hair in scripture.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And then you'll shave your beard off and never grow it again.
No, I won't do that.
Hair represents deception. Yeah. That's what hair represents. And when you think about it, I go on the internet and there's this little video and there's a picture of a gentleman and another side picture of him, the same gentleman with a beard. And it says, a beard changed my life. And I think, wow, you must be a very prideful individual that the way you perceive yourself in a mirror changed your life.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
pretty shallow.
That's pretty
pretty shallow when you think about it.
Yeah.
And why do we do the things we do? It's like people say, well, Jesus had long hair. Well, that's interesting because that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says that a priest is to keep his hair trimmed short and his beard trimmed short.
He's
not to allow it to grow long, lest...
I thought they weren't supposed to trim the ends of their beard.
Oh.
It's like it was either shave it or grow it.
You're getting into the Pharisees' idea of keeping a beard. You're moving away from the spiritual into the literal.
Well, I know, that's what I remember the verse saying.
Let me see if I can think of where it is.
Probably Leviticus.
Trimmed.
Yeah. The thing I didn't like is it made it seem like have enough faith and you'll be healed or whatever. And there's been times where had enough faith and nothing happened, right?
I question too much now because this guy can be confusing. I talk about you a lot now.
That's cool.
That's a good thing.
It's in Ezekiel 44:20. They must not shave their heads or let their hair grow long, but they are to keep the hair of their heads trimmed short. No priest is to drink wine when he enters the inner court. And it goes on.
That's
a little interesting. You wonder, well, why?
Where's that why? Where's that found?
Like Ezekiel 44.
That's the New Testament.
21. Yeah, that's the Old Testament.
Old Testament. Mm-hmm. That's where it's found then. No priest should drink wine when he enters the inner court. That's when it's talking about you should be careful with anybody in authority. Like a pastor shouldn't drink. It's right there.
It says no priest is to drink wine when he enters the inner court. Ask yourself what the inner court is.
If a pastor ministry, right? Where he's got a
we're in the inner court right now.
It's a shepherd.
We're in the inner court.
Yeah.
So is it wrong for someone to drink wine? No.
No.
But is it wrong for someone to drink wine before they go to service? Is it wrong for someone to drink wine and then sit down to help someone else understand what the scriptures are telling us? Just two people. That's all you need.
Yeah.
So is it right then to be drinking wine while you're or alcohol or whatever spirits when you're seeking God? The answer is no. So if the priest comes in with alcohol in his breast, throw him out. You'll learn real quick. If you can't stand before me sober and tell me the truth, I sure don't need you standing before me half-cut telling me lies. It's that simple. Stay away. Not interested.
That's the priest.
Yeah. Like, well, priest, pastor, rabbi, all the same thing. Shepherd, all the same thing. Person who claims to be a prophet, all the same thing.
People in authority, yeah. People that are teaching.
YouTube is absolutely full of these guys who... They grow a long beard, they get their hair going a little bit long, you know, if it's not quite white enough, they put a bit of peroxide in there to get it lightened up a little bit, you know, and they get their shawl out and everything, you know, and they're on there and they've got their desk and all their paraphernalia all set up in front of them, and now they're going to speak to the camera and play like they're a prophet. It's just a bunch of liars. It's like
It's crazy.
It's like sitting and watching little children, 2 to 6. Let's go that. They get into the attic and they open a box, and inside are, oh, there's hats for the ladies and the men, there's shoes, there's coats, old-time coats and stuff, and they decide to play dress-up. So the little girl's got her grandma's hat on, big hat with flowers on top and everything, you know, and she's got a pair of shoes on that are this long, and her little feet are only that long, you know, but trying to walk around in the attic, and they've got the umbrella out, and the little guy's got grandpa's cane, and they're all wandering around, and they're having a great time. Don't do that in the pulpit.
Yeah.
Don't do that in the pulpit. But that's all there is.
Of course not.
Today, that's all there is.
Yeah.
In the pulpit. They don't know what they're talking about, because if they knew what they're talking about, my God, their message would be completely different. They wouldn't be spouting off about last week's fishing trip or trying to...
That's nothing. Talking about a fishing trip is not as bad as playing the rock, heavy rock music right at the altar when we should be having service.
Yeah.
That's something I could... If Pastor Douglas would have walked in his church that day, he would have kicked them all out. I guarantee it, no matter what.
Maybe. I don't know. Pastor Douglas won't have anything to do with me anymore, so... You figured it.
I don't know why, but...
He was sitting there in front of the I shouldn't say any of this stuff on my camera.
Yeah, okay.
I stood up and said that it was wrong. The message was that if you're amongst people, and the example that was given was a young man at work. Someone brought a skin magazine to work. Young man's a Christian. The people he worked with knew he was a Christian and knew that he was against pornography and all this kind of stuff. So they're purposely egging him on. Now, the purpose we should be learning about in church is how to do battle against the enemy. Because this is a war we're in. This is not playtime. This is a war. Our enemy is falsehood. He hates truth, first and foremost. So we as students, as young people, being prepared in life for war, have to learn how to fight. So the representation was put forward that just run away. Run away? If we lived in the 16th century and you were taken out onto the battlefield, handed a sword, and told, there's the enemy, fight, and you turned around and ran away, do you know what would happen to you? Someone put an arrow in your back. You'd be branded a coward and you'd be dead. If you went back just 100 years and you did that, you would be dead.
What did he do? He said to run?
It was his recommendation that the best thing to do in that situation is turn around and leave. Leave it alone. Just ignore it. Leave. Leave the room.
What would you do?
That doesn't help anyone fight. Nor does it. The person says, well, I love the guys at work. I wish I could help them. Learn how to fight the devil, and you'll be able to help them. So I stood up and said no.
What would you have done if that happened to you? Would you have left?
What would I do?
Yeah, it's happened to me. I'm telling you, it happened to me.
Simple, isn't it? Here's the skin book.
I know, but what
if somebody is saying, oh, look at this chick, look at that chick.
No.
Beautiful. Listen, I'm teaching you something.
Yeah.
I'm showing you what you do. She's very pretty. There's no question, God blessed her with a beautiful, beautiful face, beautiful body. I wonder what her dad thinks.
Now you already saw that. You went there and looked at it. You gotta be
strong. Sure I went and looked at it. What do you think? That a picture on a page is gonna jump out and I don't know, pick something out of my brain and destroy me?
No, but that's what mine. Some people can't do that. They have to leave because it would bother them too much.
Why? Because they don't know how to fight. Why am I doing this? Why am I saying? You bring out the pictures. Yeah, she's very pretty. How would her dad feel? You know, it says in the Bible.
Or what if that was
our Lord Jesus was talking, and he said, you know, if you lust after a woman, you've committed adultery with her. You've had sex with her in your mind. You've married her. Look after her.
Make a good point.
So, you know, guys, you're sitting here and you're looking at these skin books and everything, and you're admiring these beautiful women. You ready to marry them all? And take care of them the rest of their life? Are you ready for that, boys?
Can't afford that.
No. Well, you know, you should fear God a little bit, because God said that this will make you go blind. Didn't you know that pornography can make you go blind?
I don't remember what I did, but I think I left the room, but it wasn't, they were playing the porno actually, so I had to leave, but I was just, I think I stood my grounds, but then they all made fun of me saying I want to walk out in the water.
Who cares if they make fun of me?
But like that's what they did. Literally, I hit him in Canada. That's exactly what they did. Oh, then they always bugged me. They bugged me for years after that. They went and dirt, like, but no, I didn't. I left because I didn't want to get in, especially at work. But technically, maybe I should have went. Then I would have been the rat, though. When I went to the boss, and so what do you know? You got to be careful too. But I don't know.
Well, he gave you a good example there.
Oh, yeah. I can give you enough examples to.
By running,
do you harm?
Running's not necessarily the wrong answer, but you also got to say why you're running. Maybe that's what he forgot to say.
And maybe in the course of them playing a movie, maybe leaving the room is the right way to go.
Yeah, see,
that wasn't the example that was being given, but when you're talking about just the example that was being used was just a skin book brought to work and people giving you a hard time about it. What can you do? Well, you stand up and you draw the sword and you fight. As soon as I start talking about the Word of God, you know, Jesus said, well, there's the sword. The sword is the Word of God. Bring it out. You know, truth and love. If that was your sister, and I was visiting your place, and I was ogling your sister, stripping her right in front of you, with my own mind, making comments about your sister, how would you feel? Would you be a happy camper? My nose might be bleeding, eh? Yeah. So, if you want to do right, don't do something to somebody else that you wouldn't appreciate being done to you. If you wouldn't appreciate me ogling over your sister, then don't ogle over mine. And when you're talking about these ladies that, God, they've got to be hurting. They've got to be hurting. Because look at these men. They treat them like
this generation
chattel.
Is crazy.
Yeah. Just objects of their lust.
Sitting at Tim Hortons, it's getting bad out here. There's freaking brass knuckles and everything out there now. I actually held a pair of brass knuckles today.
I got brass knuckles.
That's so cool.
I know how to use them too.
Yeah, they're illegal.
Nor am I afraid to use them.
It's such a cool, like, I don't know who this guy is. Like, he's
always, the more we can prepare ourselves, it's just like going to boot camp. The more you can train in anything, in building tables, the more me and Murray train ourselves in how to build tables that look nice, are durable, legs don't get floppy on them. The more we can learn, the better we're going to be at building tables. The more we can learn about our Lord and the advice that he gives us in his word, the better equipped we are to do battle against the enemy. And when you look at the people that are around you, you look at people you call friend. And when you can recognize the enemy, you see what's wrong in everything. You see what's wrong.
Sometimes you gotta stop. Like today I was with, what's your name? I always forget your name.
Leanne.
And I was with Leanne and Brittany was with us and like we had a deep conversation, she was listening, but there's some things we have to shut up about because didn't want to offend her, but she knows the truth. Like we were talking, you know, so like she's like, should I even say this? I'm like, well, you could if you want, but she might, you know.
Well, as brothers and sisters in Christ, there should be nothing that offends any of us. Nothing.
Ideally, yeah.
I was
not even a skin book.
This is not a skin book.
Okay, crazy. It's really nice.
Just for the camera, it's not a skin book.
It's really nice to see her seeking God the way she is right now. Like, I love talking to her about God. She just loves God. No, it's
did you hear about her cancer?
She talked a little bit about it, but not much. Yeah, we talked more about God and how I talked about this weekend and what was said, and she enjoyed it. I just shared what was said, and it was really nice.
No, it's... We raised children, and all of us have experienced some degree of raising children. We watch other people's children being raised, or we raise our own. And what do we do in the course of raising children? Well, we educate them. We teach them as much as we can, so that that knowledge then can protect them. No one can take it from them. One thing that no man can steal from you is wisdom.
I like that sermon he gave this weekend. He's like, because often older people are like, you know, the young people and you know, this, that, they shouldn't be touching our stuff and because they're too young. And he's like, he hears it all the time because the guy's the boss of the Pentecostal Assemblies there. He was preaching this weekend, and he's like, well, you know, like, they buy a piano, they put it there, but they lock it when they go on vacation. And so that's not really like God's looking for a different kind of heart. But he's like, in reality, a father always usually has to pay for their son, you know? So what do you think I look
There's
up to?
There's an expense. There's a sacrifice.
What do you think I look up to? Like, I look up to my elders, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not saying they're going to pay for everything, because one day I'll probably have to pay for... I did already pay out lots for the younger people, but that's because I am a father, but that it made so much sense when I heard that. It's like, the elders... shouldn't complain about the younger generation. They should be loving them and seeking. Like, it's obviously going to be, God never changes, but this world, like the things in this world, well, it's getting pretty bad out there, but I'm sure it was bad in the 60s too, you know. It's always the same, but
it's always the same.
But I guess new technology, you know.
Here's one for you.
I just like what
you said. Do you know what it means to eat flesh?
Flesh, like
In the Bible, in the Old Testament, it says that the Israelites ate the flesh of their children.
Must be talking about something different.
Oh boy, is it ever. People do it today, and as you just said, it's disgusting. To eat flesh means to slander.
That's it, yeah, I know.
To slander. Mm-hmm. So, when you eat the flesh of your children, then you've got bad things to say about your kids instead of good things. Your mind is set on all the mistakes they make and not all the successes that they've come to embrace. And it's disgusting. Men eat the flesh of their wives.
That can be very dirty. Frighten me. What do you mean by that?
Slander.
Okay.
I don't know why I married that bitch. My goodness sake, she can't cook worth a damn.
That's my mind worrying, sorry.
See what I mean?
Yeah.
Slander. And they do it all the time. I'd go to work and I'd sit there and listen to it for a few minutes, and finally I'd just get upset and tell them to shut the hell up. You got nothing that good to say about your wife? Man, you're one lousy judge of character, aren't you? You married her. She was good enough for you when you chose her. Now all of a sudden she's garbage. You have got a very poor method of judging anything, don't you? You're the dummy. You married her. She's not. You're the dummy. But husbands, they're not satisfied with their wives. They talk about the 7-year itch and all this kind of stuff. You know, what the? What kind of freaks walk this earth? You picked that woman. You made a promise to God. I'll tell you a little story. It's a true story. The reason I bring this one up is because these folks are in town this weekend. They live way farther south. But a girl grew up with my daughter. They started kindergarten together, and they finished high school together. They've been best friends their whole life. They're still best friends. Wendy's friend chose a young man to marry. That was fine. They invited us to their wedding. I don't know how good an idea that was, but they invited me to their wedding. I went. I stood in the audience and I watched them give their wedding vows and everything. And at the end, they walked down the center aisle and stood at the back doors and greeted everyone as we all came out of the church. And when they got to me, the gentleman, the groom, put out his hand and I took his hand. And I didn't let go of it. And I bent in and I said to him, I said, remember this one thing. You invited me, you asked me to come to your wedding, to witness, to bear witness of the vows you just made before God. I'll hold you to those vows.